Thank you for returning to the session. Actually, you know, like there's many say that banking is many years ahead of insurance when it comes to innovation and applying fintech and working together with fintechs. And I must say we tend to agree. And that's also why we are so pleased that Marcus Pertelwieser, the Chief Digital Officer of Deutsche Bank, is willing to share his experience with us to, we can learn so much from adjacencies, and banking is one adjacency for sure. Marcus, can you please describe what you are doing at Deutsche Bank and what the challenges of Deutsche Bank are?
Yeah, sure, Roger. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation, for the very kind introduction. I think I have never been introduced on stage that we are ahead, so this is really great news to us. Thank you. Yeah, what I'm doing at Deutsche Bank, I'm the Chief Digital Officer. I have the pleasure now for about 3 years to manage our digital agenda. And this compromises transforming our core business, building up new businesses. I'm responsible, for example, for our digital factory, where we have 400 people. So it's a really interesting portfolio, doing corporations, mainly with fintechs, also with one or the other insurtech. And also we're doing some investments here on the digital agenda. So it's a broad portfolio of tasks I have.
You mentioned the digital factory. I think that the audience is very curious what it really entails. Could you share a bit more about, you mentioned 400 people?
Yes. So the digital factory is basically our development department. When we started the digital journey 3 years ago, we believe that banking will probably not a winner takes it all, but we will see a clear consolidation. And therefore, we believe it's extremely important that you are leading in banking. In order to be leading in banking, you have to be leading in digital. And the premise for leading in digital is a strong research and development capabilities. Therefore, we built as Deutsche Bank a couple of innovation labs all over the globe, one in San Francisco, one in London, one in Berlin. There will be soon one in Asia. There's now one in New York. So this is the heart of the research capabilities. And the digital factory, where we have 400 people, this is the development capabilities. We have colleagues from Deutsche Bank, business and IT, fintech people, externals, also some people from risk and from compliance. You also need these people when you are a bank, because you can't be agile. If the little guy comes in the last day, then probably you are anti-agile. So this is an area where 400 people working like in a startup. That's very often the feedback we receive, that it not only looks like a fintech or a startup, that people really love working there. And for me, the most important innovation we did in the last 18 months is not single service, it's the digital factory, because now we have 400 people that can do a kind of innovation at a larger scale.
When you speak about the different research hubs that you have across the globe, do you have a specific focus area for each hub?
Yes, we have. So in the Berlin hub, this is the classical, more retail banky API stuff we are doing there. London is our hub for the blockchain initiatives, because there is lots of blockchain expertise, both in London but also from our colleagues. The guys in San Francisco, they have to focus on artificial intelligence because they are close to the valley. And in New York, we have lots of expertise, especially on cybersecurity. So these are a bit the main areas of focus. We are not doing that on our own. For example, in San Francisco, IBM is our partner. HCL is in London. So we have in Microsoft in Berlin. So close or in line with the topic, we have chosen our partners there.
So you're actually building a whole ecosystem of suppliers, also on that level, to to actually accelerate innovation.
Yeah, absolutely. Because one of our core beliefs is, if you want to succeed in digital, you will never be able to do that on your own. You need really strong partners. Also, a big change, because when I joined Deutsche Bank in 2008, everybody was keen on how you can best manage your internal resources. When you're in a platform economy, it's still important, but decisive is whether you have a great ecosystem of external partners, and that's also a part of the research and development capability.
So you work together with the likes of IBM, HCL, and also Microsoft,
yes.
And on the other end, also with much smaller fintechs.
Yes.
Can you share a bit about your experience with that?
Yeah, sure. I'm a great fan of fintech. We have now 12 collaborations, not announced, they are live. I think that's very important because when you're in banking, you have very great stories about we are initiating any kind of cooperation, but for me, it's not communications, it's delivery. So they are partners all in different areas, like in robo-advice, also in identity management, deposit marketplace, and so on and so on. My view is many of them started as B2C, and throughout their journey, they moved to B2B businesses, because in banking, and I think it's not so different to insurance, customers value trust, you need access to the customers, these are strengths of a bank, and so we have built lots of win-win situations, like the word fintech says itself, it's a combination of financial and of technology, and therefore they are very, very, very valuable partners in terms of technology. And I think it's absolutely fair to say that a lot of our innovation, we would have never been that fast if we would have done it on our own. On the other hand, if you speak to the CEOs of the fintechs, they also tell me that on their own, it also would have been very difficult.
When you think of all these different parties that you work with, you're able, of course, to create totally new concepts. And I think your platform thinking and how you work with that is one of the great examples of, but could you please explain a bit about, more about that?
Sure, I think everybody is talking about platforms, and so we also thought about what could platform mean for a business model, and I think technology is important, but I always like to say digitalization is not an upgrade of the IT, it's a revolution of the business model. And therefore the question is, what could platform economy mean for a bank? And the easy thing is to say, if Uber has no cars and Airbnb no beds, I think a retail bank maybe will not have a balance sheet. And even if you start discussion like that in a bank, somebody say, okay, no, this guy is getting foolish, that's not possible. Yes, I think that. First of all, we believe that, and we did lots of customer research, that with all the excitement about new kind of services, at least Germans are not interested in having 5, 10, or 20 different apps in order to do their financial services. So it's first of all about multi-banking aggregation. You can have all your banking accounts in one place. But this is only the basis then in order to provide kind of platforms, because we believe in digital, it's not about having the best product, but giving access to the best products. And that's one reason why Deutsche Bank customers are now able to buy deposit products from non-Deutsche Bank, from selected banks. That's a kind of a curated marketplace. I think here in InsurTech, non-life insurance business is also about to become a true platform, and even maybe we can also then talk about kind of bank assurance. I think there's a great chance for a revival of that concept thanks to digital. And the true power that is about, thanks to the to API, is that we have built our API, not only because PSD2 urges us to have this kind of API. We have two different ones, a smaller one and a bigger one. And so now we started corporations with fintech, offering them a much greater API so they can build up their businesses there. And maybe not now, but in 12 to 18 months, our goal is to have a kind of an app store for services in banking and beyond that is not built by the bank, but by third parties.
Looking at those kind of services, those are services that play a much important role in the context of financial services rather than in the financial service itself.
Exactly, because I think it's not sufficient for us to have a great banking experience because customers don't decide between banking experience and non-banking experience, they just want to have a great experience. And we in Deutsche Bank always say it's so important that you are relevant on a daily basis. And I think so far bank products, except the account and the payments, are not relevant on a daily basis. And therefore, it's important to have different kind of services that go beyond banking, like we say, because that is of utmost importance that we keep the customer relationship. And maybe to add on the fintechs, these fintechs that go for the customer relationship, they are competitors to us, because I think that's also part of the platform economy. If you have the customer relationship, you can understand the customer much better than if you're only a service provider. So you really have to decide either you're the platform provider or you're the infrastructure guy. And this is also part of the concept.
I think this is also an important one, because when I look at, for instance, payments, I see that more and more payments are becoming invisible. Think of machine-to-machine payments. I'm thinking of, for instance, what Amazon is doing with Dash. So if payments become more invisible, I sort of see the same thing happening also in insurance. Insurance might also become invisible in terms that you purchase a product and there's already an insurance embedded in that. How do you cope with the problem of invisibility?
I think the disruptive trend behind the story you told is that thanks to the cloud, thanks to artificial intelligence, many of the products we see today become kind as a service. When we speak about payment, I think everybody is speaking about the classical e-commerce payment. I think here it's important to have in mind that this is less than 10% of the overall payment volume. But the two very important points is one, there will be instant payments, or also thanks to PSD2, there will be account information and payment initiation. So the payment will change completely. And how we look from a strategic point of view is probably 10, 15 years ago, there was e-commerce. So I think PayPal did a great job. Then now we are all about this kind of mobile commerce. Probably the device producers are in a good position. But we personally believe that at some point of time, the identity and the payment will converge. So it's very important who will provide the infrastructure for the digital identity and how you can combine it. And that is, by the way, one reason why we did with a couple of other big companies started this kind of Verimi, this digital identity and payment platform, because this could serve this demand of the customers. And then I think it's also a good example that this is not owned only by a bank, it will be also an ecosystem that can provide that service.
It's very interesting that you mentioned that yesterday Vikas Kharia of AXA Group mentioned the national ID platform in India that could provide the next generation of platforms also for insurance. Yes. But looking at, for instance, you just mentioned PSD2, that's something that we did not really touch upon in these days. But PSD2 is the new Payment Services Directive by the EU, and it actually makes it obligatory for banks to open up to third parties so that they can provide new services, opt-in services to customers. What kind of opportunities do you see for insurance firms to use that directive to become even closer to customers?
I think, first of all, it offers each and everyone the opportunity to be closer to customers, and I think that is very important, and that's when I first may start with the perspective of the banking industry and then move on to the insurance industry. I think the original intention was to increase the competition between the banks in order to make the payment products better and more safe from a customer point of view. And if you speak to some of the politicians that were involved, I think I can only say that was my impression. It was not their goal to make it that open and to make it that broad. But now everybody can kind of offering a kind of account information service of payment initiation service. By the way, we started the service, we are open, or the account aggregation using all this kind of information already 1 year ago, because one thing in Germany is different. In Germany, we have a kind of HBCI standard, which already allows you doing this kind of aggregation services. So it's a bigger revolution in other parts of Europe. But from an insurance point of view, if you have the trust of the customer, if the customer says, yes, I open my account information, probably to get kind of benefits, probably also some rebates, I think then the great opportunity is to link the insurance product to a kind of payment. So this brings you one step closer to the customer, maybe not that close that you have to be, because when you see the transaction is also is already done. But I think that's for all, and not only for the insurance companies, a great opportunity to have a much more individual, much more real-time kind of service offering.
So this is really about integrating things in the customer experience that people already have with, for instance, their banks. Is that also looking at, for instance, the future of bank assurance that you envision, something that is on the radar?
So when I first mentioned, I think it was a year ago, that I see the big potential for the revival of the bank assurance, my perspective was a bit different because our customer research showed us that customers are really interested in having all their financials in one place, on one view. And by the way, customers typically don't differentiate between banking products and insurance products. That's more driven by the regulation, more driven by how the industry is structured. And the reason, from my point of view, why bank assurance didn't work well 10 to 15 years ago is that you don't have a bank advisor that is really interested in selling insurance product, and there are no insurance guys that truly want to sell bank products. So that was more a point of culture, more a point of specialization within the agents. But thanks to digital, I think most of the products, both in banking and in insurance, are commodities. They can be fully digitalized. Also, the kind of advisory process, and therefore I see great opportunities to bring this kind of bank aggregation, multi-banking, and probably not the most complicated life insurance products in the beginning, but all the P&C business can be easily automated. And then your question on PSD2, I think both banks and insurance companies, if you have the data, I think it's easy to build a kind of a non-life broker that is closely linked to your payment data. And I think that's a great opportunity. And I think also, and here we are in very good talks with a couple of you guys, because I see here the insurance or the insurtech companies with a great opportunity also to move into the customer relationship.
I think that's also a different area that we can really learn from what happens currently in banking, and particularly in private banking. Mm-hmm. I think of robo-advice, mm-hmm. Robin, what you're currently doing there.
Yes.
Of course, robo-advice is very much on the radar also in insurance.
Yeah.
But what can we learn? What are your learnings so far?
Mm. Well, I think the story about a robo-advice is a great one. First of all, that shows how powerful digital could be, because the most valuable investment product, a discretionary portfolio management, that in the classical days you had to invest $500,000, $1 million, because it's extremely costly in terms of production, because you need many humans in order to provide the service. This is now fully democratized, because even our Robin will start with €5,000, and you have the full expertise of the bank. Where it's a bit misleading is, why is this a robo? I don't like this phrase, because the asset allocation, that means how much you invest in equity, bonds, America, Europe, and so on, this is not done by the machine. That's done by man, by human, because this is the capital market expertise. What is done by the robo is the risk management and the rebalancing, but this is no robo advisory. These are just algos behind. I think the robo advisory we will see in banking, this will be done by artificial intelligence, because if you believe, and I do that artificial intelligence will replace the diagnostics in medicine, I don't know, in 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, whenever, I think everybody should be aware that financial need analysis is much less complicated than the medicine part. So I think here it can be extremely helpful, and that means for a bank that advisory talks with the customer do not start with half an hour asking for all the data. The data is already there. There's already a proposal. So the relationship manager or the machine, depending on the customer's preference, they can directly start and kind of interacting with the customers, can explain. And I think there's no difference between banking and insurance. So the question is, where do you have human interaction? And especially, what is the value add of the human in this discussion?
So it's really a question of creating hybrid models and creating the best of both worlds in that area.
Absolutely. That is our experience, that not for the classical banking and payment stuff, but if you are buying a mortgage, if you are going for an investment of a greater scale, people very often ask for human interaction. That must not always be in the branch, for sure. This can be remote, this can be something else, but I think hybrid is the solution for many client needs, yes.
Many things that you speak about and that are originating in the digital factory at some point need to go to move to a next level at scale. What are your learnings that you would share with the audience? That how would you scale things internally, for instance?
I think first of all, and now I can speak more to the incumbents than to the insurtechs, because there I spent the last 10 years of my life. I think one experience for me that is very important, people that are working in a bank or in an insurance company, they are as smart as guys that are working in the Silicon Valley. The main difference is, how do you interact with each other? What are the processes around? And that was the reason why we came up with the Digital Factory, because here you have a completely different setup where people really can take risk, and if something fails, no issue, because if you never fail, probably you were never innovative, you were never aggressive enough. So this is good to have these kind of island. We have decided for 400 people. Why 400 people? Because that was the size of the building. If the building would have been bigger, probably it would have been 600 or 700. And I think it's good to have a facility like that for 1 year or 1.5. You can bring in people from the rest of the bank, but then you have to scale. Because I think we were successful in digital when we stopped talking about digital, because it has to be an integral part. So the next step is to bring this different kind of working or collaborating now to our headquarters, probably floor by floor. And I'm in very good discussions with my colleagues from HR, from compliance, from legal, because they must be integral part of this kind of digital factory.
It asks for new competencies, and for instance, HR, they really need to comply with those new competencies.
Absolutely, and I mean, they also have to think about how HR changes in a world of digital, and like the topic we had before, if it's all about collaborating, it's about having external partners, probably a full employeeship for the next 40 years is not that what people are looking for, and this is only very obvious, but also in terms of careers, in terms of remuneration, and so on and so on, probably digital changes everything, and for me, the biggest mindset shift is, and if you take the banking industry as a whole, for the last 10 years, this industry went through a long phase of efficiency. And when you are in an efficiency mode, it's all about doing things right. When it comes to digital, it's about doing the right things. And this is such a big difference. Like when you're at the end of an innovation cycle and you're at the beginning of an innovation cycle. And to make this everybody clear is so important, because when you're in the efficiency mode, you treat things totally different than when you're in innovation mode. And I think this is the biggest change, and we are far from being done, but I think we have a very good first half. Now we have built the foundation where we have to capitalize on, and then history will tell us whether we will succeed or not.
So moving from the doing the things right to moving doing the right things. I think that's a great conclusion that we can really all learn from. Thank you very much for sharing your vision. Thank you.
Thanks very much.